好，欢迎大家回到新加坡国立大学中文 MBA 师说新语大师讲堂的直播间。刚才我们已经听了50分钟的课，那现在呢是互动答疑的时间。那大家如果有任何关于出海的一些问题呢，我们可以在这个留言区一起来，留言，然后我们一起来解答。今天呢，我们也非常荣幸的请到了我们的金牌翻译老师 Burner 给我们进行现场翻译。好，那我们首先呢就开始我们的第一个问题。OK，Prof. Pasha, so now is the Q&A session. So we have consolidated a few questions. We would like to start the first question. So we will combine the first question and second question. OK, so I will read the question first in Chinese. 所以第一个问题呢，是我看到有观众在问，就是关于当前全球经济的不确定性比如说汇率波动啊，包括美国的这个高通胀，以及现在东南亚各国的政策的变动的不确定性。比如说我们看到7月1号的时候，印尼政府提出的将对中国的商品征收200%的关税，这个对就是这两年出海的这个跨境电商可能冲击都非常大。那企业在进入东南亚市场的时候，有哪些需要考虑的因素？那企业家如何应对这些挑战？这是第一个问题。第二个问题是类似的，那我们把它合并在一起。在东南亚市场的政策环境变化的频繁的情况下，企业应该如何建立有效的合规和风险管理的体系，以确保业务的稳定运营？有请Prof. Pasha 来回答。OK，Would you like to answer the first two questions？
Professor, do you need me to in,
Professor？
in?
Yes, I would like you to translate them for me, please, because I don't understand what the
Sure,
question.
sure. So I'll combine the first two questions. The first question is that given the current global economic uncertainties, such as exchange rate fluctuations, high inflation in Europe and the US, and unpredictable policy changes in Southeast Asia countries, for instance, the Indonesian government's proposal to impose a 200% tariff on Chinese goods from July the 1st, which poses significant challenges to Chinese cross-border e-commerce business. What factors should enterprise consider when entering the Southeast Asian market, and how should Chinese entrepreneurs respond to that? That's the first question. The second question is, in the context of frequent policy changes in the Southeast Asian market, how should enterprises establish effective compliance and risk management systems to ensure stable business operations? Professor, please.
Sure. First of all, I'll just give you my
Just
thoughts.
give you my thoughts.
I don't have a monopoly of wisdom, any of these things. So I'll just give you my thought. Geopolitical tension is nothing new. Think about Japan and the US. They're friends, right? But even then, they had a lot of trouble. Toyota's way of solving the trouble is to localize production in the US and become part of the US fabric. So there is a short-term issue, and then there is a long-term issue. In the long term, Chinese companies must win in emerging Asia if they want to be relevant. If they want to be where, let's say, German companies have been in the last 20 years, American companies has been in the last 50 years, they have to win in Asia. They have to win in Africa in the long run. In the short run, there are always geopolitical tensions. One way to address would be very simple. Try to align your interest with the interest of the country. For example, some of these are democracies. Democracies want to be re-elected. So can you help them get re-elected? One of the reasons why Chinese companies, state-owned enterprises are very successful in Africa is because they're able to replicate models of infrastructure from China in a very quick time in Africa, like in Ethiopia. So now, if you are and government, which needs for re-election, you want to show that you can deliver. So try, there will be somebody who can decide either to accept your proposal or not to accept your proposal. Try to put yourself in the minds of that. And one of your customers is not just that, the government is also a customer. That's what I'm trying to say. So think about what the government wants.
好，非常感谢这个问题啊，我不是一个 这个垄断这方面的一个我不是这个一定说我的这个智慧就适用了，但是可能有几个东西我想要跟大家分享的。第一个就是说地缘政治的这个紧张关系的话，这也不是什么新的东西了。我们看一下日本和美国，他们过去呢也是朋友，是吧？但是呢也有很多的麻烦。那丰田当时怎么样解决这个麻烦呢？就是到美国去设厂，去本地化它的生产，成为美国社会的一部分。那么这是其实是一个长期的问题，所以有长期有短期。我们先说长期的问题怎么解决呢？就是中国的公司呢必须要在新兴的市场，像这个亚洲市场呢，东南亚市场呢，必须要得胜。像过去的这个德国公司啊，美国公司在20年到50年之内，他们都在亚洲市场取得了自己的这个得胜的地位。那我们中国的公司呢，这个比如说在像非洲这样的话，长期呢也是要亚洲都是要取得我们这个得胜的地位。那么在短期来说呢，还是有这个地缘政治的紧张关系的。所以其中一个方式要解决这个地缘政治的紧张关系的也比较简单，就是要把你自己的利益和当地的国家的利益相一致，相对齐。那比如说呢，有一些这个民主国家他们要进行竞选，是吧？要进行大选，要重新的这个选举，那你能不能够帮助他们再次赢得选举？那中国公司其中能够得胜的一个原因呢，就是比如说国有企业在非洲之前是非常成功的，因为他们可以复制在中国的基础设施的模型，然后把它快速的搬到非洲去进行建设，然后对待当地政府的话也是支持他们去重新的当选。所以这些的话就决定了说对方能不能够接受你的提议，是吧？然后你要用他们的这个角度去思考，然后为客户去思考，因为政府呢这里也是一个客户，也是你的客户。
Okay, so Prof. Pasha, have you finished answering the first two questions?
Yes.
Okay, 好的，谢谢谢谢 Pasha 教授给我们回答了头两个问题。那我们来看下一个问题哈，下一个问题是，好的，现在的在各个平台的问题非常多 ，We have so many questions coming in. Okay, 下一个问题是比较有意思，是关于这个文化上的一个跨文化的管理和本地化哈。The next question is about the cross-cultural management. 所以我来念一下这个问题哈，就是印尼的这个员工倾向于更放松的一个工作节奏，而中国的企业的员工已经适应了非常强的这种996的高强度的工作模式。那我们呢已经把内卷的文化带到东南亚的时候，其实有很多的会产生很多的企业的冲突。那您认为在这个跨文化的这个商业环境中，企业应该如何去处理这种文化价值观的冲突，来确保企业文化的和管理的方式能够在东南亚新兴市场可以得到这个认可和适应？那如何去平衡这个个人绩效和文化价值观上的冲突？那企业可以采取怎样的一些激励的机制，或者是灵活工作的安排，来确保员工的工作的满意度和生产力？如何这个保证这个生产力？
So the question is that Indonesian employees tend to prefer a more relaxed workspace, the employees in China tend to custom to get used to the intense 996 work schedule. When introducing the involution culture of China to Southeast Asia market, many conflicts may arise within the company. So in your opinion, how should companies handle these cultural and value conflicts in a cross-cultural business environment to ensure the corporate culture and the management practices are recognized and adapted to the emerging Southeast Asian market? What incentive mechanisms and flexible work arrangements can enterprises adopt to balance the individual performance versus the cultural value conflicts, ensuring the employees' job satisfaction and productivity?
Actually, this question is close to my heart. So last couple of months ago, I was teaching an MBA class, and one of my students from China gave me a very interesting example. He was in Indonesia, and he was originally based in Shanghai, but his company, he's quite very senior. His company sent him to Indonesia to do some business, and he ended up in a dinner with the president of a company, a Chinese company, and during the dinner, the president of the Chinese company told my student that, you know, compared to the Chinese workers, Indonesian workers are a bit less, they don't work as hard. So I have to basically get people from China to do the job, because the student, the workers from China can do it in 3 months that the Indonesian would take 6 months. So my student told me that after he had the dinner, he came home and he had a call with his mother. Mother is in China. So the mother, he told the story to his mother, and the mother gave a very interesting anecdote to my student. His mother told him that, you know, in 1990s, the biggest employer in Shanghai was Bao Steel. So supposedly in mid-1990s, Japanese companies came to restructure the steel company, and they brought a lot of Japanese workers. And exactly the same reason, supposedly Chinese workers were lazy. They take breaks very often. They take lunches, they take tea, and they read newspaper. So the point that my Chinese students was telling me and to the rest of the class was that actually what we are talking about Indonesians today is what the Japanese were talking about the Chinese then. The reason I liked that example very much is because, you know, what we call culture is often driven by the reality of the situation. If you change the incentives, people's habits will change. It's not the other way around. So you have to understand why people behave in a certain way, what their issues are. And it's often, once we talk about big cultural difference, it becomes very difficult for us to handle. My own experience is that cultural differences, I don't think matter that much. You have to understand some basic understanding. You have to respect the people. But it's often a shortcut way of saying that, oh, this cannot be done. It's not like that. It's even in Bangladesh, where I'm from, I used to believe that people in my country are lazy, because I grew up in 1980s Bangladesh, where most of the state-owned enterprises were, and the bosses used to take evening nap. And then I came to Singapore in 1999, and I saw all the roads were being constructed by workers from Bangladesh at 2 o'clock in the afternoon when the sun is right there. So it completely shattered my own stereotype about my own people. I realized the people I was around, they were lazy, not Bangladeshis. So the same thing is, if we can create the infrastructure, if we create the incentives, if we create, people will behave not that differently. Of course, there are some basic fundamental cultural differences. For examples, we don't drink in Bangladesh, generally speaking. Muslims do not like to drink, we do not drink alcohol. No, some do, but you have to understand certain basic things. But those are simple. Those are basically simply at the cosmetic level, like changing your jacket. The most important thing is basic respect for people. If you have respect for people, people can see that. And that's the best way for you to make them work for you. So this, the fundamental thing is the respect. And if you don't have respect, they can tell that too.
Hmm. 问到我心里了，因为在2个月之前呢，我有上一节这个 EMBA 的课程，然后我的一个学生，来自中国的一个学生，给我讲了一个非常有趣的例子。然后他当时呢是在印尼，他之前是住在上海，然后他的公司呢也是在上海，然后呢公司派他去印尼，他其实是很高位的一个高管，然后他去了印尼之后呢，就跟一个这个中国公司在印尼当地的一个总裁两个人吃晚饭。晚饭的时候呢，这个中国公司的总裁呢就跟我这个学生讲说，和中国的工人相比啊，印尼的工人呢就是有点懒，他们的工作没那么努力。然后中国的人呢这个工作很努力，所以他要把这个中国人呢运到印尼去，去到那里去工作。那我的这个而且呢，他比如说中国人花3个月做成的事情呢，印尼人要做6个月的时间。那在晚宴之后呢，我的这个学生回到家就跟他的母亲通电话，母亲呢是在中国，然后母亲呢就给他讲了一个故事啊，非常有趣的一个例子。他说，在90年代的时候，当时上海最大的这个雇主就是宝钢，然后呢在90年代中期呢，日本的这些公司呢 来重组，到中国去重组这个钢铁公司。当时呢，他们也是假定说中国的这些工人呢非常懒。工作懒散，然后每天吃早饭，吃完早饭吃午饭，吃完吃午饭之间还有茶点，还要喝茶，还要看报纸，是吧？这个，所以呢，这里其实这个中国学生想要告诉我的就是，他在这个90年代中国和就是日本和中国所经历的这个例子，其实就是现在中国和印尼所面对的这样的一个例子。那文化呢本身它其实是由现实的这个情况所推动的，如果你改变了它的刺激因素，它的动机，它的习惯也就会相应的发生改变，而不是相反的一个方向。所以你必须要人们了解人们他的行为方式是来源于什么样的原因，他们的问题出在哪里，而不是简简单单扔出一个大的理由说啊，这是文化差异，我很难这个去应对这样。什么是文化差异呢？就是你必须要了解基本的，有一个基本的了解，人们之间可能会有一些个差异，有一些不同，你要去尊重人。但是如果你把这些都归咎于文化差异，这其实就是一个走捷径，说我不能够把这个事情办成了。那甚至比如说我举个例子，在孟加拉啊，我小的时候是住在孟加拉，那个时候我长大的时候是80年代，我认为呢，当时孟加拉人呢非常懒。那大部分的这些企业呢，这个他们到中午的时候都午睡。后来呢，我在99年的时候来了新加坡，然后我就发现，在马路上做工的这些建筑工人都是孟加拉的工人，他们在下午2点的时候在大太阳底下晒着，却是非常勤奋的这个工作，这个就改变了我对于我自己的孟加拉人的这样的一个陈词滥调的这种看法，这种陈腐的一个看法。所以我发现懒呢不是孟加拉人懒，而是由于当时那个基础设施，你给了他什么样的一个刺激，导致了他的行为会产生这样的一些个差异和不同。所以基本的最基本的这种文化差异啊，其实并没有那么大啊。那我们在孟加拉，比如说我们是不喝酒的，因为是穆斯林国家嘛，不喝酒精，但是也有人呢可能会饮酒，所以这个最基本的这个文化的这些差异，你需要去理解，然后你需要去尊重，它只是一个简单的一个外衣而已。当你给了人们尊重的话，这个才是最好的让他们去心甘情愿为你工作的一种方式，因为他们能够看得出来你是尊重他的。
Okay, Prof. Pasha, you finish answering the questions?
Yes, I gave a long answer,
okay.
Sorry.
Thank you. 谢谢 Prof. Pasha. 我觉得完全同意啊，就是 Prof. Pasha 刚才讲的这个。那我们看到接下来的问题哈，有很多朋友问到关于这个本土化，因为其实这也是非常实际的一个挑战。那我来这个念一下这个问题哈。首先这个第三个问题是第四个问题是在产品本土化的过程中，企业往往会遇到比如说关于专利、税收、营销本地化的一些难题，那您认为企业应该如何在这个方面进行有效的调整和优化，以确保产品能够进入东南亚市场？那另外一个问题呢，也是关于本土化的，我就一起来念哈。那根据这个当地本地客户的喜好和调整产品的时候，可能会面临就是这个产品的特性和优势可能会减弱的这个风险。那您认为企业在这种情况下，它如何平衡它产品这个本土化和它原有的这个核心竞争力之间的这个关系请 Brandon 来翻译一下。
So I will combine number 4 and number 5, the two questions together, because they are all related to localization. So question number 4 is that during the product localization process, enterprises often encounter challenges related to patents, taxes, and marketing localization. How do you think companies should effectively adjust and optimize in these areas to ensure successful entry into the Southeast Asian market? The next question is, when adjusting products to local customer preferences, there may be a risk of weakening the original product features and advantages. How do you think companies can balance the product localization and maintaining their core competitiveness in such situations?
Again, thank you for this question. This is also close to my heart because I will answer the second part of the question first, and then I will address the first one. The question about the second part is how to balance the core competence and the localization. My answer is my core competence means nothing. You see, I'm giving this talk in English, but not Chinese. If I could speak in Chinese, that would be very useful. But at the same time, I cannot speak Finnish. Is that a problem for you? Not really, because my audience, they don't understand Finnish. I don't understand Finnish. So my core competence means nothing if my customers don't care. Now, you might argue that, look, your core competence is highly valued to customers in the US. Then go and sell to the US. If you want to sell to Indonesia, and if winning in Indonesia matters, it's the same thing. If a German company wants to sell to Chinese customers and Chinese customers want different things, then complaining that their core competence is not matching would be very simple. Then don't go to China. Go and sell to the places where you can have your core competence matching customer needs. So the point I'm trying to say is success depends because somebody is willing to pay for my product and service. Simple. If people don't want to pay for my product and service, I do not exist as a company. And if you believe that you need to get those customers from emerging markets, then you need to localize. Your core company, whether you have it or you don't have it, it doesn't matter. If you don't have it, you have to gain it somehow. Otherwise, you will not be able to win that market. So simple. And then going to the first question is patents and some of these things. Hire locals. Understand that it's exactly the same thing. Think about American companies, Japanese companies, when they come to China, how do they survive Chinese patent laws? So it's the same thing. When Chinese companies only recently, they're developing their own core competences. So they have to play by the rules of the game. There's no other way. But the most important point is I want you to understand your core competence doesn't mean much. It only valuable to the point that your customer that you want to get cares about your competence and your competitors cannot replicate. If they can replicate your core competence, then your core competence means nothing also.
这个问题也是问到我心坎里面了，其实呢，我先回答你的这个问题的第二部分，然后再回答第一部分。这个问题的第二部分呢，就是说怎么样去平衡我的核心竞争力与本地化、当地化的这个之间的一个平衡。那我的这个答案其实就是你的核心竞争力其实什么都没有用啊，没什么用啊，因为你要看。 我自己呢是讲英文的，我不会讲中文，但是我今天呢如果会讲英文，面对这些学生呢，可能面对你们呢就会非常的有用。那同样呢，我也不会讲芬兰语，你们也不会讲芬兰语，所以这个芬兰语对我们来说其实都没有什么意义。那如果我有这个芬兰语的核心优势，这个核心的竞争力它其实在这里呢是没有任何意义的，因为我的顾客他们是不在乎的。 所以你可能会说，哦，你的这个核心竞争力啊，对于美国的顾客来说是有很高的价值，没问题啊，那你就去美国去销售就可以了。你如果要比如说服务印尼，想要在印尼这边取得胜利，那相同的你必须要考虑在印尼的客户他想什么。如果一个德国公司想要卖东西到中国去，他就必须要了解中国客户的需求的这个差异，然后这个如果说他的核心的这个竞争优势。 有一个不匹配，那他要不然就很简单，不要去中国市场，要不然他就放弃这个核心竞争优势，然后去匹配中国的客户的这个需求。所以这里我想要讲的就是说，成功它是依赖于谁来为你付钱买你的产品、买你的服务的这些人的。所以非常简单，如果人们不愿意付钱买你的产品服务，那你做一个公司就没办法生存。 所以我觉得，对于新兴市场的这些客户来说，你首先呢要把你的核心竞争力呢本地化，然后呢，不管你有没有都没有关系，如果你有，你就可以把它本地化；没有的话，那你就去建立你的这个核心的竞争优势，要不然你在那个市场里面是没有办法得胜、没有办法活下来的。第二个，这个就是你问的这个第一个问题，就是专利啊、税务啊等等这些，其实答案也很简单，就是去招募本地人，去理解他们的当地的一些个法律法规。你思考一下，当时美国公司、日本公司，当他们去到中国的时候，他们是在怎么这个符合中国的法律的要求？比如说这个中国的专利法等等，这些都是同样的手段嘛，是吧？现在。 最近呢，中国的公司开始出海了，他们有了自己的核心的竞争力，有了自己的这个游戏规则。 就有了自己的这些个这个竞争力和知识产权，但是你必须要按照对方的游戏规则来行事，没有其他的一个办法。所以这里非常重要，我需要大家理解的就是你的核心竞争优势对于客户来说可能并不意味着什么。所以当你的客户需要你的这些竞争优势的时候，你的优势才会有价值。那同时呢，你的竞争对手也不能够复制它。如果你的竞争对手能够轻易的复制你的核心竞争优势，那这个竞争优势也就没什么意义了。
好的，谢谢 Bernard 的翻译。Professor, you finish answering the question?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. 谢谢 Professor 的这个给我们的这个解释哈，我是非常认可。我也觉得就是说，以人为本，客户为先。如果没有创造这个，没有为客户创造价值的，其实核心竞争力其实什么都不算。那好，那我们现在来看下一个问题哈，是关于这个关于中国汽车的一个问题。Pasha 教授，东盟国家的人们如何来看待中国汽车？那您认为中国汽车进入东盟市场是好事还是坏事？因为关于这个新能源汽车，其实也是大家这2年关注的一个焦点。那我们请教授来给我们解读一下。
Hey, Professor, the next question is about the cars automobile industry from China. So how does ASEAN countries or ASEAN people consider Chinese cars, and how do you see the penetration of the Chinese cars into ASEAN countries? Is it good or bad? Because recent year in the recent years, the new EV, the new energy you know, vehicles is a very hot topic, and how do you think about it?
Good for whom? Bad for whom? Now, if you're Toyota, it's not such a good thing. But if you're BYD, if it's the other Chinese companies, it's a very good thing. Now, good or bad, it depends. Customers decide whether they will buy or not. If you add value, they will buy. American people, they buy Toyota, Japanese cars, right? They didn't always used to buying Japanese cars. They grew up buying American cars. Now, in Southeast Asia, Japanese cars are by far the most popular. Now, it's not going to be easy for Chinese companies to match the quality of Japanese cars, but they are doing it by using different technologies like EV, where the Chinese companies have a head start. Now, it won't be easy, but at the end, the decision would be in the hands of the customers. If you add value, they will buy your products. They don't care if it's Chinese car, Japanese car, American car, Bangladeshi car. They'll basically buy the car which adds the highest value to them.
那回答你这个问题啊，其实好还是坏是要看公司看人的。如果是对于这个丰田来说，它可能并不是一个特别好的一个情况。但是如果对于像中国的这些汽车制造商，像这个比亚迪啊，这可能是一个好事情。那所以这个就要看客户他来决定，他们想不想要买啊，他们有没有看到价值。就像美国人现在他们也买日本的车子，是吧？他们并不是这样，以前他们就是习惯买美国的车子，后来他们开始也买日本的车子。而在东南亚呢，日本的车子呢是非常受欢迎，目前来说还是最受欢迎的。如果你想要期待中国的汽车公司能够去达到日本的车子这个质量，那可能还是不太一样的。不太容易的，但是呢，你可以去关注在不同的这个科技上面，比如说这个 EV 电动车，那中国的公司呢就会有一个很好的一个开端，所以这个也不是很容易，但是最终决策还是在消费者的手中。如果你能增加价值，他们就会买你的这个产品，所以他们其实不在乎说这个车子是中国人造的，还是日本人，还是美国人，还是孟加拉人造的，他买这个车子就是因为他从中得到了最高的价值。
好，谢谢 Bernard，谢谢 Professor。好，那我们接下来看下一个问题哈。下一个问题是关于这个是非常有意思一个问题啊，我来念一下。您如何看待亚洲经济的增长与过去中国和印度的成功增长有什么不同？我们是否应该预见未来的增长主要由人口、自然资源，还是由政府政策的驱动？哪种因素可能是做出更大的贡献？因为我们看到，其实这个东南亚市场也有很大的这个人口的红利，那是否会有同样的这种增长呢？我们来听听 Pasha 的一个他的解读，来，请你帮他翻译一下。
Professor, this is a very interesting question. How will you see the growth of economies in Asia different from the past success of China and India's growth? Shall we foresee the growth mainly driven by population and natural resources or government policies? The high could make which factor could make the biggest contribution? Because we see there are some population dividends in Southeast Asia right now. Do you foresee that could be the biggest contribution to success?
It's a good question because it's a very difficult question. But I want us to see the very fundamental, actually. China also had a large population for a very long time, but didn't necessarily mean that China was always very rich for the last 100 years. So it's not necessarily having population will mean that you necessarily grow. It's basically if you have the system, the incentives that would allow these people, you have to have the market. Now, when you are poor, it's easy to grow from like where Bangladesh is, it's or where Indonesia is. From Indonesia is about $5,000 GDP per capita. $5,000 GDP per capita to $10,000 is relatively easy. You have to build the infrastructure so that different parts of the, it has lots of islands, so you can create a single market. India is about $2,700 GDP per capita, even poorer, half than Indonesia, meaning much easier. It's like China 20 years ago. 20 years ago, China was growing at more than 12% because it was very poor. As you get richer and richer and richer, just growth by increasing the labor and increasing capital becomes harder and harder. You have to, as you have more, because you're not going to turn everybody into computer scientists, and population will eventually go down. And once you build the once you build the infrastructure, like rail lines and everything, you're not going to break them and rebuild again. So the difficulty is once the capital and labor, both things are taken care of, you have to be very productive. The most of the Asian countries are far from that. So they will continue to go much faster for the next 20 years. Now, I'm talking about India, Indonesia, Pakistan, Bangladesh, because they are so far from the frontier, just basic things will need a lot of premium. Now, if they cannot do so, having large population is a problem. Think about, as I said again, China. China had a large population 100 years ago too. It didn't really help China much unless the system was there to actually to make them into productive citizens. India needs education. Bangladesh needs education. China built a good education system at the basics. That's why, despite all this geopolitical tension, my view about China is quite positive because China's emphasis on education. Education does not depreciate like the way the building depreciates. You can bomb the buildings, but you cannot bomb the people's education. So that's why Japan could come back after Second World War. Germany could come back from devastation. So basic education is the way to move forward if you want to take advantage of demographic dividend. Otherwise, you're going to have chaos. You're going to have revolution. Big problem.
这个问题也是非常好，就是原因呢是因为这个问题非常难回答。那我想要给大家讲一下这个最一些个基本的东西。其实中国的话，它也是在过去很长时间有非常大的人口。那但是这不一定意味着说中国就是在过去的100年呢都是非常的富有。那就是人口不一定说意味着一定会带来增长和成长。那基本上我们需要的是什么？是系统，是一些个激励政策才能够让，还有就是说有市场才能够让你这个国家发展成熟。所以很容易的，比如这个成长的这个市场，比如说像孟加拉像印尼，这个印尼的话，它现在人均的 GDP 是5000美金，那如果要增加到10000美金，人均10000美金，但相对还是比较这个容易的，只需要建基础设施就可以了。但是不同的就是说，它有很多的岛，你需要有一个单一的一个创造一个单一一个模式去把它复制到各个岛，也是挺难的。印度呢？人均的 GDP 是2700美金，所以他要想这个只有一半是吧？他想要这个富有的话，其实更容易，但是呢，这个你看一下中国20年前的这个样子，那个时候是12%的一个年度 GDP 的一个增长，非常非常穷啊，现在呢是越来越富了， 所以它需要这种增长的话，需要资本，需要劳动力，然后呢，你也不能把所有人都变成计算机科学家，这个人口呢，它最终呢，还是会停滞，甚至说是这个缩小。所以你除了建基础设施，你还要建一些真正的，就比如说铁路啊，这些个楼房啊，这些东西呢，你没有办法把它这个打破了，然后再重建，它只是一个大部分时候是一个一次性的。然后就是劳动力和资本，这个是你要照顾好的，你要提高生产力。而大部分的亚洲国家呢，离着这个富有还是差得非常远，他们现在还没有度过这个快速增长的前20年，所以它还可以继续往前跑。比如说我讲的这个印度啊、印尼啊、巴基斯坦啊，还有孟加拉，他们其实都是这样的一个市场，他们离着这个前沿的东西还差很远很远。所以呢，我们还会有很长时间的这个红利时代在等着他们啊。这个大这个人口过大呢，它也是一个问题。那比如说中国的话，这个100年前，它的人口就已经很大了，但是也没有帮助中国很多的事情，除非你已经有一个很好的一个系统，是吧？让通过这个系统，让你的生产力增长，让你的这个公民受到的教育多。所以，印度、这个孟加拉、巴基斯坦这些呢，他们都需要教育，而中国之所以成功，就是它建了一个非常好的一个教育系统。那么，在这个地缘政治现在这么紧张的一个关系下呢，中国还能够保持正增长，非常积极的，就是因为他们一直在关注在教育，教育呢，它是不会贬值的。你这个楼呢，建好了之后，它慢慢的可以贬值。那人们如果比如开战了，它可以这个炸弹炸过来炸你的这个楼，但是它炸不了你这个国家的教育。所以这也是为什么日本呢，在二战之后很快就复苏了，然后德国二战之后也是很快就复苏了。所以基本的教育才是未来发展的一个方向，所以你要借助人口的这个发展的话，你就必须要重视教育，要不然的话，可能人口大带来的却是混乱，可能就会有革命啊等等这些大的问题出现。
好，谢谢 Bernard 的翻译。Thanks, Professor. Because the time limited, so we come to the last question. We'll take the question eight. 我们现在来回因为这个时间的关系哈，因为我们也看到这个直播间有很多的问题，但是由于时间的关系，我们再来请 Professor 来回答最后一个问题。我来念一下这个问题是：请问老师如何来看待东南亚市场的碎片化问题？那未来这个市场会逐步的统一吗？
So because of the time limit, we are left with the last question. So the question is, how do you view the issue of fragmentation in the Southeast Asian market? Would this market gradually become a one unified market in the future?
Not anytime soon, because look at European Union. European Union, they came together because of political, some ideological coherence. In Southeast Asia, the differences are people have very different ideologies. So it's unlikely that it is come together the way you see as an European Union in terms of a political, almost like a political union and monetary union. That's not going to happen so soon. I don't know if it will ever happen. I don't even know if it is better if that happens. What is going to happen and already happening in the last 20 years is these countries are becoming a lot closer because of complementarities in trade relations. So they're coming together as an ecosystem where they trade with each other, and China played a very important role in the last 20 years in bringing all these countries together as a cohesive block. Now, when I say cohesive, it's not that they're politically cohesive, but their economic interests have become very closely tied. Now, it also the geopolitics could cause some kind of dent in the next maybe, but in the long run, this is something I really want us to understand the history. You see, the China has been in this region for a very long time. But even if you look at 500, 600, 700 years ago, people have been doing trade between China, Southeast Asia. Southeast Asian people have been doing trade all the way to Madagascar. If you look at the time of Majapahit Empire and all these things. So Indonesia, Indians have been doing trade in Thailand, have been doing things. So this that the idea of this trade route has been there before 300 years, 200 years, it will come back because this is where the economic logic is. Whether it's going to be the same as European Union, not anytime soon.
这个问题非常好啊，但是我答案我觉得就是和欧盟相比啊，它这个不会那么快啊，能够形成这样的一种这个统一化。
好的，谢谢 Bernard。Thanks, Professor。由于时间的关系呢，今天我们的互动答疑就暂时告一段落。Now we have come to the end of the Q&A session, and thanks, Professor. Would you like to say a few words to the audience, to wrap up this Q&A session, Professor?
Thank you so much for listening to me. In all sincerity, I do not really know if I have the answer to these questions. So I just gave you my thought, and there are so many different answers. So I just gave you what I think is probably the answer, but I change my mind very quickly. So tomorrow I might change my mind.
非常感谢大家这个收听我这个部分的一个演讲。 对于这些问题的话，我其实没有所有的答案，可能会有很多很多不同的这个想法，我只是分享了我现在这个时候的一些想法。 但是呢，也可能我的这个改变，我的想法呢，明天就会变，所以跟我今天的这个想法就会发生差异了。对，都是有这个可能的。好，谢谢
Pasha 教授非常精彩的Q&A的这个分享哈，也谢谢 Bernard 给我们非常精彩的一个翻译。Thank you, Professor, for your very insightful sharing. And thanks, Bernard, for your translation. I really appreciate your time spending with us tonight, and have a good evening. I will start the next session.